At the end of May 1921, the nation's capital played host to a multiracial, interfaith gathering, the likes of which had rarely been seen in the segregated South. For 3 days, thousands of people assembled at the First Congregational Church of Washington, D.C., in the first ever convention for amity between the colored and white races. One of the key contributors to this history-making visionary event was an African-American son of slaves who was a man of deep faith, a scholar, a lawyer, an ardent believer in race unity. His name was Lewis G. Gregory. The narrative that frames this documentary is taken from his diary reports of events at the 1921 National Convention of Amity Between the Races.
The North and the South, Orient and Occident, colored and white, mingled in a picturesque setting of 5 sessions over a period of 3 days. The First Congregational Church, which in past years had welcomed so many liberal and progressive groups, opened its doors for all sessions. Among the distinguished people who aided the endeavor were Reverend Dr. Jason Noble Pierce, Honorable Moses E. Clapp, former senator from Nebraska, Senator Samuel Shortridge of California, C. Lee Cook, famous Southern businessman, Dr. Elaine Locke, Honorable Martin B. Madden, congressman from Illinois, William H. Randall, Professor George W. Cook, Mrs. Coralie Franklin Cook, Roy C. Wilhelm, Janabi E. Fadl Mezandariani of Iran, and Lieutenant General Nelson A. Miles, commanding the American Army.
I attended every session, day and night. Many times throughout the meetings did with much effort restrain my tears. My heart leapt and throbbed and many times almost burst within my breast. I am a colored man. My race as a whole, I believe, is quite ready to welcome the glad day when all will be brothers. The trouble is nearly unilateral. God, give us the day.
It was a time not unlike today. 50 years had elapsed since the Civil War and the emancipation of America's enslaved people. At the federal level, Reconstruction amendments passed in the immediate aftermath of the Civil War recognized the humanity of African Americans, but Jim Crow laws in the South encroached on nearly every aspect of life. America's apartheid, Jim Crow first impinged on voting rights won after the war. Then, step by step, inch by inch, Jim Crow outlawed even the most superficial of cross-racial mingling. Schools, hospitals, amusement parks, train platforms, bus depots, doctors' waiting rooms, restrooms, post office and bank teller windows. At the same time, the Ku Klux Klan arose again to enforce the Jim Crow social order.
Terrible, horrendous things happening to blacks, lynching and burning people. And not only that, we also have to remember that these lynchings and burning of people, they would invite men, women, and children and see these things, you see. And so you had a culture. It was a celebration of the denigration, you know, of black folk.
Then in 1919, the nation's capital and more than 30 other American cities erupted into violence and chaos, incited by white mobs in unprovoked attacks on blacks.
What we see in 1919, in various places, you know, throughout the country, most certainly in Chicago and D.C., is that blacks are showing defiance and they're showing a willingness to fight back rather than to just be victimized.
This first race amity convention, then, provided stark contrast to the prevailing patterns of the era. Thousands of men and women from various racial backgrounds, hues, cultural traditions, and social classes, chose to sit shoulder to shoulder in church pews for three straight days, a simple but truly revolutionary act.
The specific purpose of this initial convention was race understanding. Eloquent addresses, large audiences responding not only to the wide press notices, but the circulation of 19,000 programs, ideal weather, and an atmosphere that was spiritual and heavenly could have but an extraordinary effect. And the spirit of reconciliation seemed to sweep the city. This convention had the fervent approval of the President of the United States, although officially he took no part in it. The gratitude of the chief executive may be well understood when it is recalled that but a short time before, the historic city had been violently disturbed by a race riot fatal to many. Now the cleansing and purifying power of the Holy Spirit was at work, bringing harmony and peace to those who had passed through the shadow of death.
Whether aware of it or not, when convention goers stepped through the doors of the church, they also stepped into the flow of the other tradition.
There have been people all over the country, all through history, who have been able to envision a different kind of society.
We know about the tradition of racism, and it's important that we study the tradition of racism. But at the same time, we need to understand that there's a parallel tradition. They're interrelated.
The other tradition is something where people from different racial ethnic groups have worked together to address social injustices throughout history.
The other tradition dates back to the origins of European settlement in North America. In 1619, early colonists captured African men and brought them in bondage to Jamestown, Virginia. While enslavement grew in reach, the other tradition freshened the historically rich soil of the colonial period. As interracial communities appeared along Virginia's eastern shore, from about 1650 to 1670, blacks and whites in these communities exchanged land and livestock, hired and fired each other, rented rooms in each other's homes, and cross-racial marriage and adoption became commonplace. As history unfolded, this ever-present other tradition of cross-racial collaboration was practiced. Blacks and whites formed bands of brotherhood while fighting alongside one another in the Revolutionary War, created an underground railroad for the protection and safe passage of the enslaved who sought freedom, joined ranks again to save the Union during the Civil War, and sat in legislative halls together during Reconstruction to actively envision an interracial democracy. Sometimes quiet, sometimes loud, often hidden or overlooked, this other tradition has always been present, characterized by close collaboration, amity, and mutual respect. The other tradition responded to the tumult leading up to 1921. Interracial co-workers established the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People and the National Urban League at the national level. Inspiring a network of chapters across the nation, they provided a forum for blacks and whites to advance access, equity, and social justice. And in 1921, the movement of race amity conventions began with religious inspiration. Race amity conventions were envisioned by a spiritual leader living in the Middle East. Abdul Baha was the son of the founder of the Baha'i faith, a religion whose central principle is the oneness of mankind. He traveled to the United States in 1912 and studied the situation of race relations from afar for many years.
Abdul Baha envisioned a new sociology for the world in general and America in particular. He invites the attention of social workers to the oases rather than the deserts of their environments and helps them to extend the boundaries. In this nation's internal development, there is no more lurid and tragic chapter than that of race relations. It is to this, therefore, that Abdu'l-Bahá directed his great thought, turning his searchlight upon the national disease and prescribing with marvelous wisdom the remedy.
You know, Abdu'l-Bahá constantly talked about the importance of racial unity. He described the whites as pearls and the blacks as sapphires. So he created a lexicon of racial or interracial appreciation.
When it came to the first Race Amity Convention, Abdu'l-Bahá placed responsibility squarely on the shoulders of a woman by the name of Mrs. Agnes S. Parsons.
Agnes Parsons, this Washington, D.C. socialite who had very little exposure to African Americans. She wasn't necessarily what you would call the most progressive person. She wasn't a Jane Addams. She wasn't a radical white woman, okay? So why did he pick her?
The call for blacks and whites to come together for a new effort to abolish prejudice needed to come from a well-to-do white person, not from African Americans who could easily be sidelined and disregarded.
With famed philosopher, educator, and Rhodes Scholar Alain Locke serving as chair of one of the sessions, the program included talks on the spiritual and scientific components of interracial brotherhood. Artistic presentations celebrated black culture through a musical performance by violinist Joseph Douglas, grandson of Frederick Douglas. A talk on black poets by Coralie Cook, a professor at Howard University. And an evening of traditional African-American spirituals with historical commentary given by Howard University Director of Music, Gabrielle Pelham, and the University Dean of Music, Lou LeVere. In modern minds, performances of black music and poetry are commonplace, and perhaps even the stereotypical role assigned to black presenters. But from the time of emancipation onward, Jim Crow had been aided by a propaganda campaign against black people. Scholar W.E.B. Du Bois called it one of the most stupendous efforts the world ever saw to discredit human beings. This campaign involved universities, history, science, social life, and religion, and placed into the minds of Americans from kindergarten through adulthood that people of African descent had never contributed to civilization. The convention's focus on celebrating black civilization served as both education and healing. Shortly thereafter, Alain Locke launched the revolutionary framework for African-American scholarship and artistic expression in initiating the Harlem Renaissance, the fountainhead of African-American scholarship, to advance American intellectual and artistic expression. This first Race Amity Convention sparked a national movement of large-scale interracial gatherings. Washington, D.C. hosted three more conventions in 1922, 1923, and then formed a racial amity discussion group led by Coralie Cook and Agnes Parsons. Springfield, Massachusetts also held a convention in the winter of 1921. In 1924, New York City saw a collaborative effort between the national leadership of the NAACP, National Urban League, and the Baha'i community. At that city's convention, Alain Locke shared the stage with W.E.B. Du Bois, Jane Addams, and James Weldon Johnson. Throughout the 1920s, conventions took place in Philadelphia, Boston, Chicago, Montreal, Detroit, and Pittsburgh. Even small communities in the Rocky Mountains were inspired to hold interracial dinners and discussions. These race amity gatherings and conferences were held off and on in various cities into the 21st century. In 2011, on the 90th anniversary of the 1921 conference, the National Center for Race Amity committed to revive and hold a National Race Amity Conference. This commitment led to the May 21st, 2021 convening of the centenary celebration of that first conference 100 years earlier. No student of history could say race amity conventions solved America's struggle with racism. However, despite the tumult then and now, we must mark with joy and take inspiration of this 100th anniversary of the first Race Amity Convention. It celebrates a moment in time when, in the midst of crisis, chaos, and violence, there is a present and growing moral consensus which has as its center amity and association. This moves us towards E Pluribus Unum, as we become the better in us. This is our nation's vision and our destiny.